Good evening, everyone. I'm really happy to be here and very honored and to speak and to present what I'm doing and what we were creating, and to relate also to this conference and to what other speakers did. I'm really glad that I've been invited from Tirana Art Lab, and I'm really thankful for that. Thank you very much. I will, at the beginning, I will actually present some positions which are important to understand the case study, which I will present after it. Because in my research, activist, political and artwork, I was dealing a lot with the issues of artwork, of labor, of work, and generally what is the relation of work and art and artwork and how it is related. And in that context, we organized last year a seminar in Norway, in Trondheim, where Jelena Vesic was participating, for example, and some other people from different groups like Art Leaks, from where I'm coming from, also Art Leaks Collective, and then Vage from New York and Occupy Museums, people from Occupy Museums, and a lot of other people who are dealing with this issue. And we were discussing about what means like transformative art production today, and what means are the coalition buildings with social movements, with workers, in the context of politics, in the context of art and activism. Because it is important for us like to understand how the artwork can be placed in the today context of the neoliberal politics. And this is just like one segment from this text that was written for the conference, where we were telling that actually today the artistic work has become an entrepreneurial activity within a restrictive framework conditioned by the expanding art markets and hegemonic political agendas, which are prescribing the usefulness of art. But the division of labor in the creative and knowledge industries has formed huge masses of artists that serve as a reserve army for cheap creative labor. I'm now relating to the much broader understanding of artist and art worker today. I also think about designers and people who are working in creative industry. And it is actually for us it was important to understand how we can create a better coalition building between the initiatives who are struggling and fighting for the better material condition of workers and of artists. So just to come to a kind of slogan, this is like one of drawing that I did for after actually this seminar. And this is just like one of the slogans that you can have in head, and then when we come to the case study that which I would speak about more precisely, you will understand how we were relating to this historical and heritage from the socialism in Croatia. We call for abolition of division of labor, for the dissolution of the categories of art and labor, and for the redistribution of work. And it's important also to say that in this text that came out from the seminar, that the recommendations for alliances and coalition building are also designed and discussed. And those kinds of alliances are very complicated to create today, because the capitalist reality is fragmenting extremely our social and our working life. So in that sense, to create a coalition building in the sense of political coalitions and how the artist can contribute to other fields was very important to us to analyze and to think about how to do this. having in mind that during the socialism time such coalitions were existing, and this reality was something which was completely there. It was not fragmentation like this one in neoliberal condition didn't exist. And this is also important to say that emancipatory force of art can only be realized if art doesn't exploit social movements in the interest of art, but if art becomes a means in the hands of the people. Alliances and coalition can only become sustainable if solidarity is developed in a struggle for mutual liberation and not through patronizing attitudes. Okay, now I will go to the case study of the which I will present and my research, and how I was, together with my partner Rena Redle, how we were applying all these ideas of dealing with art and labor and artwork. So, the question for us was how to deal with the question of the artwork, art, labor, and so on, in the context of the of the socialist heritage, like. What left from the socialism? What are the objects? What are the traces of socialism? And how we can relate to it? What we can learn out from it? How we can use this to, in the today, for example, emancipatory struggle? This was a very important question for us. Which artistic praxis and researchers can bring transformative potential today? So this was important for us. And we started to develop this through research, through artistic research and also theoretical research. And I will now show you the, how this research was going. So I'm showing you now my and Rena's artistic research that was lasting for, let's say, 6 months or 8 months, and the result of this research. So this research was happening in, was placed in Croatia, and as most of the countries in the Balkans, Croatia, socio-political and socio-economical and political context in Croatia is like the industrialization, process of deindustrialization, neoliberalism, unemployment, debt, post-war condition, which is much very very important for the Balkan, for the ex-Yugoslav countries, and also like right-wing neoliberal government, which is for privatization of everything, cutting the public sector, and so on. Then we have reactionary politics toward the monuments in Croatia. We have revision of history accompanied with socialist, partisan, anti-fascist monuments in Croatia being evicted, destroyed, and abandoned. Especially during the war, a lot of monuments were absolutely destroyed. Like, looks like this. I don't know precisely the number. Some colleagues from Croatia knows what was the number, some astronomic number of destroyed monuments from socialism. Like, this is a context where we are now in Croatia. And what is built in Croatia, those are the monuments of Franja Tuđman. He is the Franko Tuđman. He is the anti-communist president of the first independent, or actually second independent Croatian Republic, which was created somehow in the context of the EU expansion. And those are the monuments dedicated to Dr. Franko Tuđman, lot of postmodernist kind of pluralist forms in different kind of shapes, and I don't know what. In every city almost you have this kind of monument of Franko Tuđman. And then you have monuments who are dedicated to the Middle Age, a lot of like Middle Age kings. Or, for example, this Glagolic alphabet monument, which is important for our work, and it is not so, like it would be much more typical to show some kings here, because they are like imploding, but Glagolic alphabet is of importance of our work, and I will show you later how it was related. So this one is from the island Krk, and this is a letter from the Glagolic alphabet. And Glagolic alphabet was created in the 9th century. It's some kind of the proto-Cyrillic alphabet that was used all around the Slavic kind of barbaric lands. and was created by the Byzantine monks. And in Croatia was celebrated as the original Croatian kind of medieval proof of literacy among Croatians. This is also like one dedication of the monument and also the connection to this alphabet. Okay, now we are coming to the place where our research took part the most. And this is the Sisak Ironworks. Sisak is a city which lies somewhere, let's say, 80 kilometers south of Zagreb, in direction to Bosnia, and it's an ancient city. It was a Roman city, in the very important Roman city when the Romans were printing also money, because it has two big rivers, Sava and Kupa, which are confluencing, and it is an old industry city. And after the Second World War, industry was expanding there, and this Sisak Ironworks was the one of the biggest industrial giants in the Socialist Federative Republic of Yugoslavia. It employed 14,000 people. So this is really a huge number of workers that were working there. Like in the peak of its existence, it employed 14,000 people. So like now you cannot find any company that is employing such an amount of workers, such a number of workers in the whole Balkans. This is how it looks like. It is it is abandoned. It was privatized. The Russians bought it. Italians, they sold what they could. It was destroyed also during the war. Like the whole, let's say, the landscape of Sisak Ironworks now looks completely destroyed, damaged, deindustrialized. This is how it looks inside. Okay, but what was important for us in the Sisak Ironworks? Sisak Ironworks, and probably you know about that, like in many other companies, that socialist self-management was practiced, and that initiative came in the Sisak Ironworks directly from the worker to establish different cultural activities, like a lot of cultural activities. In the beginning, it was like, for example, music band of the workers. Worker did some also sculpturing things and so on. But in the end, they employed a person who was an art historian, and she was responsible only for cultural events. And they had also a team of workers that was responsible for cultural events. So such a big company was organizing themselves. It had some kind of cultural center inside of the company. And they organized different sections of cultural activities. They had the important literature prize in Croatia that was it was very prominent prize that you could get there. And it is important to say that it was not established from above, but this idea came from the workers itself. So this need to have cultural activities was connected with the workers' initiative of the Ironworks itself. And the most important thing for my work here, for our research, was that they established a colony of the fine artists, of the visual artists, that was active 20 years, and that produced a lot of objects, a lot of sculptures. Those are the workers together with artists inside of the Ironworks. So workers invited artists to develop their works, and there is a very nice catalog from the local historical museum in Sisak, of the City Museum of Sisak, where one curator there was dealing with the history of this colony and how this colony was organized. And it is very important to say in this context that artists that came here, there are like a lot of stories, like for example, artists coming from Zagreb to the Ironworks, and then they don't believe or they see like they cannot stand in this in the production for 1 hour. They fall on the ground because it is such a heat, you know. And then workers try to help them to recover and to do something with them, you know. Like, and after this process, somehow artists feel much stronger and continue to produce something which is interesting, and we will see what they have produced together, actually. Those are the groups of artists and workers, and you see here that actually, and this is very important for my case study and for my work, that those artworks were produced together. So, the artists and workers were producing artworks together. It wasn't like that, that artist was telling to the workers, you should do this and this, I am genius, I am author, you should just perform what I do. Artists were not an object, artists were put into subjectivization, they were becoming a subject in the process of production, through the process of production together with workers. So this is important to say, and this happened in Sisak in the 60s, 70s, and even in the 80s. And this was happening also in some other places in Yugoslavia, but not in all places. So we have for example, a colony of the marble sculpturing, and in the marble sculpturing factory, it wasn't like that. It came from above, the initiative for the artist colony, and this process was not done like this. So this is probably one of the best examples that artists and workers develop together artworks or objects. And what left out of this is this so-called Sisak Sculpture Park that was created in the context of this colony. And it is in the so-called part of the city called Caprag, which is part of Sisak, where there are like what left out of it are something like 40 sculptures. And they still exist there because they are placed in the living area, like between buildings. And most of them are, of course, in not so nice condition, because like 40 years passed away and nobody was renovating them. This is a map of the old sculptures. One Croatian restaurator, she did this map on Google Maps, and you can see beautiful pictures of sculptures if you click it. Just Google Sisak Sculpture Park. This is how they look like. Like, for example, Symmetry from 73. Like, they're built, most of the sculptures are actually built out from the products that the ironworks was producing. Steel tubes, steel plates, iron things, and some of them, you can refer to them almost as a ready-made kind of objects, because they are taking out from the production and from the objects which are actually produced already by the artist, by the workers for another thing. The purpose of this object was changed, again in the process together, in the together process of the work with artists and workers, and this is the outcome of it. Those steel tubes are meant to be used for something completely different, but in this context, so this is the reason why I don't refer on this sculpture as those are the typical modernist sculpture. I refer that they have a certain conceptualization, and that they have actually that how they were produced, that they are absolutely different than the sculptures which are commemorating, as huge monuments which are commemorating anti-fascist struggle or Second World War. So for me, those are two different things. Like this looks really like out from the elements. Like, for example, the title of this object is The Work Process. Yes. Or Imaginary Machine. So it is always has to do with the machine, with the process of work. And they are placed in the beautiful park and around the buildings. This is by the famous Croatian sculptor Ivan Kožarić for example, antipodes, which is actually not so much referring to what I was telling about, so I would cut Kožarić out of this. Like, this is from the galvanized steel that was also used directly in the fabric, the component. Or this one, high voltage, this is like a perfect example of this thing. So, and now we are coming to the, from where we did research and how we placed our work. It is important to understand local context there in CISAC. There are like two initiatives in CISAC. The one done by the local artist, and actually Zagreb artist, Marijan Crtalić, who was actually inviting us in the context of the Ironworks Festival, and who seeks for the possibility of resistance, active memory practices, and activist practices around this. But there are another, this is how the festival was announced. This is Marijan Crtalić's work on the Ironworks, which is dealing much more with the deindustrialization and industrialization. It is not related to the sculptures, to the sculpture park. But this is another initiative, and this is industrial heritage of the city of Sisak. And they have, so to say, completely another view. Like, they would like to brand industrial heritage of Sisak in the, like, in the context of these European projects, like to celebrate European Year of Industrial and Technical Heritage. Like, for example, in Germany they did with the Ruhrgebiet, you know, in the West Germany. Like, and to make from the industrial heritage some kind of cultural brand, you know, like this is a trend, this is how they do it, you know. And this is, so to say, a mainstream position in CISAC, like to have this kind of, like what we do now with such a huge, you know, like leftover from the industrial time, like let's make some culture brand out of it, you know. And it is important also to think about, like, how to you know, like, also to confront these kind of positions. This is now our research period. This is, for example, a sculpture of Vera Fischer, unfortunately not in the shape how it was. And here, first idea is popping up, and we say, okay, like, they have this, like, Lagodica monuments, like, let's create a language of sculptures, of the workers and an artist. We should create, it's a perfect form, this form, it is a form of this process itself, and this is a process of work between artists and workers. And this was for us a very good idea how to conceptualize the language of the sculptures, contemporary language, and I will tell a bit more later about it. This is like a first, so to say, first sketch, what to do with this. Then question of authorship. You see here, there are like two signatures. Maybe you don't see it well, but there are like two signatures. Like, the one signature is the signature of the author, of the artist, and another signature is the signature of the worker, or of the team of the worker that were working together with the artist. So the question of authorship, who is the author of this sculpture? Because in the official restoration narrative of the restoration in Croatia, you find this is Drago Hočevar, the one who was actually leading the team of the worker, of the workers who were working with artists, and the one who was initiator of the colony. He was a worker in the Ironworks. And this is, for example, his sculpture. And I will just go to this sculpture. Like, for example, there is a team of the Croatian restorators that would like to erase the name of the workers out from this memory. They would like to restore these sculptures, like this one. And they even did an interview with the artists who are still alive and asked them, like, what is yours? I mean, you have to tell me, what is your authorship? What was done wrong during the process? Probably workers were not doing exactly what you wanted, you know. And in some of the interviews which I read, workers say, artists say, well, it was well done, we had nice collaboration, it was great and so on. But in some of the cases, artists from Zagreb say, no, it was completely, they completely did something different, it is not what I wanted. And then the major question for the restaurator was, what I should do now? Shall I reconstruct the sculpture again in the shape which was actually done together with the artist, or I would, you know, like maybe destruct something and together, you know, with the artist, did the shape which was the idea of the artist without, you know, the workers' intervention. So this was the question. Like, for example, this artist called Boško Atanacković, he is still alive. He did this composition 1 and 2 from 82. And like, he never did such a shape after in his career. Like this one that looks so abstract is the only one. Like there is no one who is able to, like he never repeated these kind of things. So that this is obvious that the whole process was actually unique and placed there in Sisak. This is man machine, and this is how it was, how it looked in the beginning. It had head, now head doesn't exist. So the question for the restorator is how to produce head again. Okay, now we are coming to our, we call it artistic intervention in the context of this. And I said, it is for us the most interesting was this production of artists and workers' subjectivity, let's call it like that, or the production. And we said that actually you can probably talk about this or tackle this through artistic research rather better than through some other methods, because I think it is quite a complex creation to understand, because this creation that had happened in the Socialist Federative Republic of Yugoslavia in this special special moment with this colony and with this production, with this artworks, with this culture that were developed. This is something which was something that has to do with self-management. It is something which has to do with a lot of aspects that were matching, and it is something which has to do with the process of production as a work in the sense of. Like how I was tackling in the beginning, work as a transformative practice, a work which is related as a new production. It is not an artwork for itself and doesn't have this function. It is like a new function of it, and it is basically in the end a new language. And this is the reason why we are now coming to the question of language in this work. And for us, the question was like, we can talk about this process, like we are now, I'm not talking now about the sculptures, I'm talking about language of the sculptures. And then we can talk about this new language, this transformative language of the sculptures, only if we give the voice to the sculpture itself, but on the symbolic level, of course, because the sculpture is an evidence of the process of work. This is not a sculpture, this is just an evidence. This is material evidence of this process. And not only that, in that sense that, you know, how to talk about something which is, for example, is not about looking on these sculptures as an object, which are placed somewhere, or they are just left over, and what we are now going to do with this socialist heritage, those objects are, I don't know what, and so on. But to think about them from the position of work, and in that sense, they should witness and talk about this process of work to us. So this is a position, this is a situation. If you have them placed as a evidence of the process of work, they can address you in that sense from the position of this process of work, and not as an object, but as a speech about work. And in that sense, they can become an active memory evidence, a memory object. But how they can become active? If they don't also address some contemporary political questions there, this place. And then we decided to create a newspaper out of the shapes that are actually belonging to the sculptures. And inside of the newspaper there is a speech. We can say it's a political speech or is a poem, which is actually addressing the history, the material history of this, of those objects, and which is placing this material history in the context of this place on the political level. And we have produced this very simple kind of newspaper object that we were spreading it all around the Sisak and this and I would like to give you some of the newspapers that you can see when I'm talking about it, and not to have this distance. Probably I can order some. Probably you can help me spread it. So, because newspapers are in Croatian, Serbo-Croatian, and here is the translation in English. And for example, I will not now read the whole text. You can read it yourself and find out how it was written. We have spent a month only to write this 11 kind of sentences, and also to find out good slogans which are matching the political political context, contemporary context. Like, I will just read some of it. Like, for example, United Against Capitalist Totalitarianism. Then, let's fuel the transformation with the class consciousness of iron ore. Let's defend the fruits of collective labor. We are not allowing the future to be woven by war profiteers for the audit of every privatization. We demand the cancellation of debt for a strong optimism without sentimentality. And this is coming from the principle of hope. There are some references that are related to the principle of hope of Ernst Bloch. And I think there are something of inside of these objects which are very much have to do with this book. For the socialization evaluation of reproductive work. United despite the fragmentation and precariousness of work. This is how it looks like inside. The graphics and symbols done out from the sculptures. And this is how it looks outside. We made transparency and we have placed them in the public space in Sisak, in this neighborhood. This is process of work, of placing them, and they are near to the sculptures. So it looks like this is a text which are related to the sculptures and like the speech of the sculptures. This is now a presenting work in the context of this festival. Maybe to read this, it's not a question of affirming the sculptures as an object which are in need for protection from deterioration, but rather the revalorization of the relation at the core of the creative process. Ironworks ABC aims to speak about those relations as art, locating the symbols and language with which this is possible. Those are the images from the... And the transparents were approximately for 4 weeks or something like that. And nobody was destroying them. This was very funny. Because we thought probably somebody will destroy them, they will just take them down, and but nobody was like it. They were all around the area, but people were perceiving them as something which is interesting, funny, and which has to do with their local history, and which is also important. Before we did this, we did a lot of work and a lot of mediation, talking with people, understanding the local situation, spreading the newspaper, like we were not penetrating this space just like that, but we did a lot of precondition and talked with people how to place it. I'm not talking about organizers of the festival, but the people that live there, because organizers were not so much, didn't have so much time as we. This is, I'm spreading the newspaper in the local library, which the local library has 7 languages here, because there are like a lot of nations and a lot of different people that came to work from all around Yugoslavia, but also from abroad, like for example Czechians or Hungarians, that came also to work for the ironworks after the Second World War. And it's a very multicultural area in that sense. And okay, and this is now, I will just end up with the one question. And this question is related like how you can exhibit these kind of works in some other spaces. Because it is a question also like what you can do with this intervention, like with these things which are really site-specifically done for a certain thing, for a certain space. Or it can be mediated through this kind of discussion or conversation. So the question is like how you can place it in some other spaces, and have some other kind of layer of thinking or relating to them. So, and we have had the exhibition four or five months ago in a gallery. Actually, this is a studio of the local artist in Rijeka. There is a collective called SIS, focus group, and Nemanja Cvijanović. This is actually the ex-studio of Nemanja Cvijanović. And this is a local gallery, actually, which is run by the artists. And we have collected some of the transparents and some of the restovers which are connected to the action in Sisak, and also to some other actions of ours, like the ones from we did, for example, in Norway or in Germany or to some other places, which were also consisting of sometimes of newspapers, sometimes of some other publication or sound of different materials. So for us, it's not at the point like how to use it. And we have placed them in the, so to say, artistic studio. And it is again the question of this work and artist work and like what does it mean, you know, like how to deal with it. And I think this actually, this context of art, of ex-artist studio, and that was an artist-run gallery, was actually the unique opportunity to show this kind of constellation, because all of these works were related to the questions of labor and artwork, and art worker as a subject in that sense, or as a somebody that cannot exist for itself, as the bourgeois autonomy of art is not something which exists per se, you know, like that it needs to be put in question or questioned. And we have placed the, for example, these banners, and we have placed them on the desk in the center of the gallery, where people could sit and use them or redesign them, like rework them, where they can use this newspaper and relate to their local problems or local history or local contemporary politics. And for us, those objects at CIS were more as some kind of tools for thinking the political language of work, of art. And it was funny that it was written a critic that those symbols look like some middle age textiles from the castle or something like that. But it is maybe probably it is related to this glagolic kind of for this industrial kind of intervention into this discourse on glagolic in Croatia, and this referring to middle age and feudal thinking, that we would like to oppose or to transform in the discursive space, or in some other spaces of ideology, or in some other political spaces. And in that sense, I think that this work was successfully functioning. So, thank you very much. That's it.